let's review this 16-inch M1 Max MacBook Pro. Welcome everyone to Apple Insider. It is Andrew here, and you can find me on Twitter at Andrew_OSU. Since the 16-inch MacBook Pro has been out for a few weeks now, you've probably already watched or read 1, 2, or 5 16-inch MacBook Pro reviews. So in this video, I'm going to do things a little bit differently to hopefully keep your attention. I am first going to start off with the specs and everything to know about the machine, and then I'm going to jump in comparing specifically a 16-inch MacBook Pro versus the new 14-inch MacBook Pro. The machines now have the same internals. So is there going to be a performance difference between these two models, and is it worth it to go with that larger display? So let's go into this thing. If you want to jump around, there are chapter markers, so use those to navigate and jump to the sections that you care about. Let's start off with hitting those specs. The 16-inch MacBook Pro comes in a few configurations. The base model of the 16-inch MacBook Pro can be equipped with an M1 Pro processor, though you can go up to the M1 Max processor. In this case, we're looking at the M1 Max processor. You can choose between 16, 24, or 32 core GPU configurations. In this review, we're looking at that 32 core GPU. You can choose between 16, 32, and 64 gigs of unified memory this time. In my case, both machines we're going to be looking at are going to be 32 gigs of unified memory. Looking between the M1 Pro and the M1 Max, there's a few differences. We can dig into that in another video, which I've already done, but the biggest things you care about, there's twice the memory bandwidth going from 200 to 400 gigabytes per second. We also have support for more external monitors. You can go up to 64 gigs of RAM on that M1 Max, and it has dual video encoding and decoding engines. So if you're doing video production, that M1 Max may be the better choice for you. Other than that, the M1 Pro and M1 Max are both 10-core CPUs, and you can have up to that 32-core GPU, especially on that M1 Max. Internal storage ranges from 512 gigabytes on that entry-level model all the way up to 8 terabytes of internal SSD storage, which is just blazing fast. But for what it's worth, it's going to cost you a whole lot if you want to go with that 8-terabyte option. Then again, you can't replace it after the fact, so it may be worth it for those who use a lot of internal space and don't want to worry about toting around external SSDs. For ports, Apple has brought them back. I'm sure you guys know this, but to run through them very quickly, on the left hand, my left hand, your right side of the machine, we do have a MagSafe 3 port using that new faster charger. You can actually get 50% charge in only 30 minutes, which is pretty cool, followed by 2 Thunderbolt 4 ports. Then there is a high impedance headphone jack for upper end headphones. On my right hand side, we have an HDMI 2.0 port, followed by another Thunderbolt 4 port. That makes it 3 of those Thunderbolt 4 ports in total. And then we have an SDXC card reader. The display this year is a little bit taller to accommodate putting the menu bar up there, which does put a notch in the middle, which is where Apple houses its upgraded 1080p FaceTime camera. We do have a liquid retina XDR display. It's 16.2 inches on the diagonal, and there are rounded corners at the top, and the bottom ones are still squared off, so they match with the bottom of the machine. The display this time around is mini LED, has a 1,000,000:1 contrast ratio, 1,000 nits of brightness, and 1,600 nits of peak brightness when watching HDR content. It's also a ProMotion display and can ramp up to 120 hertz when it is necessary. For video producers, you can also dial into the specific frequency that you want for your refresh rate. So 120 hertz with ProMotion, though, it's been ill-supported here at start, not only by third-party apps, but from first-party apps as well. The original launch of the machine had Safari, and it didn't support 120 hertz. So as you can see here, we're running actually the brand new Safari technology preview, which does have support for 120 hertz. So even if we slow this down, you can see how that updated refresh rate fixes things. I mean, I don't know if you want to say fix. It's not a huge difference using it daily, but it just makes the older version feel a little more choppy than the upgraded refresh rate does. So it's just nice to have more first-party apps actually supporting ProMotion. With previous iterations of the 13-inch versus the 16-inch MacBook Pro, the 16-inch model could be equipped with higher quality components. You could get a faster processor in the 16-inch MacBook Pro than you could the 13-inch. But this year, Apple has the exact same options. you can outfit a 14-inch MacBook Pro with an M1 Max processor, the same 32 or 64 gigs of RAM. It's got the same ports. Everything's the same except for the size of the machine itself. So how much of a difference does it make? Is there a performance benefit, even though they have the same internals, is there a performance benefit by going with the larger machine? That's what I wanted to find out. So let's go and hit up some benchmarks. Starting with Geekbench 5, our 14-inch MacBook Pro with the same specs, the M1 Max processor, 32-core GPU, 32 gigs of RAM, that scored a 1780 on the single core and a 12693 on the multi-core. The 16-inch MacBook Pro got a very similar 1744, though I did get a 1784 as my max when I ran these tests multiple times. These are pretty much the same CPU, so there's not a huge difference in that single core performance. But when we go to multi-core, there was a difference, and we saw the 16-inch MacBook Pro getting a 12866. It's only about a 200-point leap, but it was faster. There was better multi-core performance on the 16-inch MacBook Pro. But if we keep going, the GPU was a whole different story. In the Geekbench 5 Compute Graphics Benchmark running under Metal, the 14-inch MacBook Pro with that same 32-core GPU, it scored a 5887, whereas the 16-inch MacBook Pro got a 69555. A huge difference, more than a 10,000-point difference between the GPU, the same GPU, in the 14-inch MacBook Pro. This is telling me that if you're looking for that graphics performance, you should lean towards the 16-inch MacBook Pro. Neither of the fans kicked on in neither the 14 or the 16-inch MacBook Pro, but possibly just Apple is pulling that performance back so it doesn't have to kick those fans on. Plus, on the 16-inch MacBook Pro, you do have an option. If you go into System Preferences and you go to, I believe it's like the battery settings, you can actually change the energy mode. You can set it to high power when it's on that power adapter and get as much performance as you can. You don't have that toggle on the 14-inch MacBook Pro. We toggled that on here on the 6-inch, and these scores are reflecting what happens when we put the machine into that high power mode. So for what it's worth, we are seeing improved GPU performance on the 16-inch MacBook Pro. That said, the video encoding engines seem to be the same because when we ran to Final Cut Pro and did our same 54-minute video output in 4K, it took me 17 minutes and 41 seconds on the 16-inch MacBook Pro, and the 14-inch only took 17 minutes and 40 seconds, pretty much the exact same time. So in terms of video output, video performance, these things should be pretty similar. The last thing that I wanted to test between the 14 and 16-inch MacBook Pro was the speakers. Apple does have larger grills on the 16-inch MacBook Pro compared to the 14-inch. When we played some music at max volume, you can see the difference in the decibel readings between the two machines. Do the scores make any difference to you? So what this really comes down to, for me, is the 16-inch is a better machine. When you're maxing these things out and you're looking for the best performance, the 16-inch does give you a slight boost in GPU performance. For people who are not relying on that GPU, our CPU performance wasn't all that different, and I would be very comfortable getting the 14-inch over the 6-inch. This thing is still a beast. It is not small, it is not light, and if we're comparing it to that 14-inch, look how much of the size difference is. I mean, if you're toting this in your bag, you wanna save some space. So I would recommend getting the 14-inch MacBook Pro if you're relying on the CPU primarily, but if you're wanting the best GPU performance, you're gonna have to go with the 16-inch again this year. If you guys are interested in either the 14 or the 16-inch MacBook Pro, you can find the best deals in the description and let me know what you think of this performance differential between these two machines on Twitter at Andrew_OSU. Otherwise, I'll catch y'all next time.